This is Blake Pavey. He's a 20-year-old comedian who got his start on TikTok.
Robbo! How are you, mate? Long time no see, big fella.
Holy storm!
He currently has more than 870,000 followers. But he's not like most comedians. Blake has a terminal illness, and it's something he's not scared to joke about.
If you don't know me, if you don't know my story, I've got something called CF, right?
A relatable comedy there for any of the dying people in the room?
Nah, guys, that's my time. Thank you so much for coming out. Good on you.
I was going into a pretty overcrowded market. I feel like there's too many just like straight white dudes trying to get up and talk about their genitals. But I still do that, but I just also talk about my terminal illness, which is always a plus comedically, I think.
And if you don't know what CF stands for, there are three names it can go by, right? There's cystic fibrosis, which is sort of the scientific name most commonly used, cystic fibrosis, right? There's 65 roses, which is a bit of a cute little rhyming name it's got going for it, sounds a bit similar, used in a lot of charity and fundraising events. And then the third one, which is what the doctors actually used on my mother, this child's fucked.
I've got cystic fibrosis, which is a, terminal respiratory sort of degenerative illness. So yeah, all the fun stuff. The main thing with CF is that a bunch of thick mucus gets trapped in your airways of your lungs, which obviously makes it, you know, very hard to breathe and all that sort of stuff. So essentially it feels like breathing through a straw pretty much throughout your whole life. So that's the main thing, but yeah, it just can also go into, you know, the ongoing risk of infections in your chest and all that sort of stuff. And then there's, you know, reproductive issues, and then just, yeah, again, all the works.
Boy, did you hear Cynthia died?
What? You're kidding.
Ah, syphilis. Terrible.
Well, when's the funeral?
I don't know. I gotta do her snap streaks, though.
What?
Yeah, gotta do her streaks.
What? Why?
Yeah, she put it in a will.
She put it in a will?
Yeah, put it in a will, so.
Well, I was going to say, I do have a 30-day streak with it.
That's the thing, you just don't want to lose it, do you?
I was diagnosed at about 6 weeks old after, you know, doing numerous tests and all that sort of stuff as a baby. And yeah, they didn't really know what was wrong with me for the first couple of weeks. I think like a lot of parents with CF, it's not something they know a whole heap about going into it. But yeah, it just takes a lot of learning and a lot of, you know, repetition of treatments and all that sort of stuff throughout many, many years. But yeah, on a case-by-case basis, depending on your severity and all that sort of stuff, your life expectancy can be shorter than most, longer than most. 20 years ago, the life expectancy was about, you know, 25, 30. Now it's about 40, 45 or something like that. But, you know, there are obviously cases of people being, you know, a lot older with it. So yeah, it's just a bit of a game of chance, really, I think. I've been pretty lucky so far to be able to sort of cruise along nicely. I haven't had too many major health scares so far. So yeah, touch wood, that keeps going the way it's going.
As I said, the life expectancy is 40, right? And I'm 20. So I'm going through my midlife crisis now, which is sort of an odd thing to go through. But the worst part about a midlife crisis at 20 is I don't have the financial freedom for it. Do you know what, mate? You're watching the movies, the bloke's going through his midlife crisis, so he'll get a Ferrari, you know, get a Lambo, splash out on a boat. I can't do that sort of stuff, guys. Best I could do, 2001 Toyota Camry from Croydon Car Sales.
Every day, you know, I'll take anywhere from, you know, 40 to 50 pills a day, a couple of nebulizers, puffers, all that sort of stuff, you know, needles and all that fun stuff. So that's the day-to-day life. And then obviously after exercise and all that sort of stuff, which I honestly probably don't do as much. I go to the pub more than I go to the gym. But yeah, that's sort of the day-to-day life for me. But yeah, I think it's sort of something I always am thinking about, but online I think I just try to keep the lighter side to it, because I don't think anybody wants the sad, sappy stuff. I'm not auditioning for Australia's Got Talent anytime soon, so I don't think that's necessary.
Yeah, just thought I'd come in, see what's going on. What else did I have to tell you? Oh, mum's cooking chow mein for dinner tonight. I'm not fucking happy about it either. It tastes like shit. But yeah, no, that'll be ready in about 20 minutes, I think. So, yeah, I think that was all I have to tell you. So I'll come grab you when that's ready. Yeah, good bonding time. Catch you later. Grandma's fucking dead, by the way.
Well, I started making videos and sort of getting a following when I was in about end of year 11, start of year 12 sort of time. So this was sort of, yeah, coming off the back end of high school, that's when everything started to kick off for me. So, yeah, I was just a normal, you know, 17-year-old kid just, you know, doing whatever a 17-year-old kid does at the time. Just, just lucky enough to fall into this sort of stuff.
Miss Green, thank you so much. Guys, how much of a legend is Miss Green? Let's give her a huge round of applause, guys. You're such a boss.
I fell into it accidentally. I started off doing online content just on TikTok and all that sort of stuff. It was really just a lot of character videos, all that sort of stuff. And then I didn't really talk about CF or anything until much later on, especially when I started to get into stand-up. So did online stuff for a couple of years there. And then over the past year, I've sort of developed more into a full-time stand-up now. So, and then the CF stuff really just, you know, I sort of gravitated towards that sort of material pretty naturally. It wasn't really a conscious choice or anything like that, but that's just what sort of that dark humor has been something that I've sort of naturally gravitated towards.
Any other dying people in the room?
Hello.
what's your name, mate? Taylor. And what's, if you have it again, what's your story, mate?
A lot of people have been connecting really, you know, really, really well to it. I get a lot of people with not just CF but other illnesses coming to shows now, and they've really said that it's been good to hear someone, you know, talk about it and raise awareness in a funny way. So that's been really great to see sort of how strongly it's sort of, you know, connected.
G'day, how's it going? A lot of yous have been asking me to talk about this. I talk about it a lot live on stage when I'm doing stand up and all that sort of stuff, but I haven't really talked about it here much. So without further ado, this is my make-a-wish story. Did I go to Disney World? Did I meet the Avengers? What did I do? I didn't go to Disney World. I'd already been to Disney World when I was like 11 or something like that. Didn't want to meet the Avengers either, because like, you know, at that point I was prepared to meet Stan Lee in a couple of years. So there's no point doing that. Bit of a dying joke there for you.
Basically, I was a huge WWE fan as a kid, as, you know, many kids, you know, like me were. So, I chose to meet John Cena, which was, yeah, pretty cool. It turns out he's done the most make-a-wishes out of, I think, any person ever. So I didn't get any points for originality when I was choosing mine, but it was still a pretty good day nonetheless.
G'day, champ. How are ya? I'm from the Make-A-Wish Foundation.
Oh, my God. Really?
Yep. Now, what is the one thing that you want more than anything in the whole wide world?
I want to meet my favourite actor in the whole world.
Oh, and who's that? Robert Downey Jr.?
Army Hammer.
You want to meet fucking who, mate?
I think I applied when I was about 11 or 12, and then we got approved for it, and then about a week before I was supposed to do it, he had scheduling conflicts and couldn't come to a show or something like that. So I was a bit devo, but decided to wait another year, and then again the next year, about a week before, he broke his nose and couldn't fly out to Australia. So I was pretty devo about that. So they kind of said to me, do you want to think of anything else? And I was like, nah, sort of, I've been in this too long to quit now. So finally got to meet him, and it was awesome.
So I was quite nervous, I was quite fidgety, and I was rushing through all of my questions, and he could sense that. So he literally just grabbed me on the shoulder and he said, take as much time as you need. I do not care if this show starts late. So that was fucking massive.
I was a bit nervy, but he was calm me down. I think he basically made the show start late just to talk to me. It was great.
Oh, bullshit. Stay the fuck away from me. Are we gonna be like that, that Cole Sprouse movie, 5 feet apart?
my life has always been, you know, keeping a humorous take on things, you know, keeping it pretty light, pretty chill, and not taking anything too seriously. So that for me has just made everything a lot easier to cope with. And yeah, especially if you're doing anything creative, I think to put that sort of stuff into it is also, yeah, pretty cathartic. So yeah, that's just what I've been doing, and it seems to be working out pretty well so far. So yeah, it's great. So I'm on tour at the moment, just as, you know, an opening act for another comedian at the moment, Luke Kidgel, on the Cheers to That tour, just another internet dude. So I've been able to work with him over the past sort of 9-10 months, just building up my my own hour of material. But yeah, we're booking in a national debut stand-up tour for me that'll be kicking off in about March next year. So we'll be touring around the country doing my own shows. So yeah, it's called Literally Dying, because I am and they will be.